goodness. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen.
Now you must get
said to them, "Take care. Be on your guard against all kinds of greed, for one's life does not consist in the abundance of possessions." Then he told them a parable. The land of a rich man produced abundantly, and he thought to himself, "What should I do, for I have no place to store my crops?" Then he said, "I will do this. I will pull down my barns and build larger ones, and there I will store all my grain and my goods. And I will say to my soul, 'Soul, you have ample goods laid up for many years. Relax, eat, drink, be merry.' But God said to him, 'You fool, this very night your life is being demanded of you, and the things you have prepared, whose will they be?' So it is with those who store up treasures for themselves that are not rich towards God." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ. Familiar faces pop up.
in their photos. The Anglican Communion is more loosely organized than the Roman Catholic Church, which is also, of course, worldwide. We have the Archbishop of Canterbury, primate of the Church of England, Justin Welby, who is our primate, but he does not have the power of Pope Francis, but he does have the authority to call the Lambeth Conference and to design its focus. So there was some drama this week when some of that oversight by the Church of England played into tensions between different parts of the Anglican Communion. Churches in Africa especially, and other parts of the Southern Hemisphere now have the most members, and they are more theologically and socially conservative. The Episcopal Church is one of the most liberal of the member churches and is the most democratically run. We elect our clergy and bishops, and there is way more lay involvement in governance with our House of Deputies. The bishops of the Episcopal Church were surprised when a call or a sort of resolution appeared on the Lambeth Conference agenda that called to affirm that marriage was exclusively between a man and a woman. And the same thing that appeared at the 1998 Lambeth Conference and was resubmitted by the organizers, the Church of England organizers, in the 2022 conference. Over the last 20 years, the Episcopal Church has worked through a lot of dialogue and dissent, more dialogue with each other after the consecration of Jean Robinson as the first openly gay bishop in 2003. We are in a very different place on this issue in 2022. We now have official rights for same-sex marriage. We have LGBTQ bishops. The bishops of the Episcopal Church and the Anglican Church of Canada made it known that they were not pleased with the substance of this call and the way it was tucked into the agenda. And they stood up for the full inclusion of our LGBTQ people. And it looks like the Lambeth leadership has taken it under advisement. Changes have been made. The bishops have agreed to disagree. Many Episcopal bishops affirm that Lambeth is supposed to create community and dialogue and not make legislative decisions. My classmate at CESP, Bishop Betsy Monat of Iowa, wrote, "I believe this is what is best about the Anglican Communion. We have no overarching legislative body that can declare an absolute position on any point of doctrine or polity. Instead, we are bound together because we choose to remain in relationship, even in the face of our deep disagreements." As I read posts about Lambeth this week, I was reminded of the messiness of church governance and church history. The Anglican Communion itself exists because of the Church of England's presence in the colonies of the British Empire, including, going back to the 18th century, the American Church. As much as I've always been an Anglophile, I realize that the Anglican Communion has its roots in colonialism. The church has always been a flawed enterprise run by human beings in all our human imperfections. As we saw this last week, Pope Francis went to Canada explicitly to apologize to Native peoples for the church's abuse of indigenous children in the church boarding schools, a horrific chapter in church history. In our reading today, we heard a passage from Ecclesiastes that is an essential cry and lament over the futility, it seems, of human endeavors. And at times, the history of the church can seem like that, all vanity. We also heard Jesus tell the parable of the rich fool. And in some ways, the historical church has been a bit like the rich fool, Over the centuries, it has often stored up riches and power for itself. In our gospel today, Jesus says it's more important to be rich towards God than rich in possessions. What does he mean? Our reading from Colossians has much to tell us about being rich towards God. First, it reminds us of our baptism. Paul writes about dying with Christ, and that is what being submerged in the waters of baptism symbolizes. And we also rise with him into a new life in Christ. When we seek to align ourselves with Christ-like values in our daily lives, we can live into our baptism and we can become rich towards God. Secondly, Paul says to put away whatever is earthly, and he has a long list of like the seven deadly sins. And he includes greed, which he calls idolatry. Again, by aligning ourselves with Christ-like values, we turn away from things like greed and idolatry, and we can become rich towards God and accept God's grace. In our gospel passage, we see the rich fool only thinking about himself when he has the abundant harvest. How can he hold on to it all for himself? Notice how he only talks to himself, too. He's not connected to the wider community. He doesn't ask how he could share his treasure with others or put it aside for the community in a famine like Joseph did in Egypt. Paul also says, in Christ there is no longer Greek and Jew, circumcised and uncircumcised, barbarian, Scythian, slave and free, but Christ is all and in all. Paul points to being in community. Perhaps richness in God means living in connection with each other and seeing ourselves as members of a wider community in Christ. Perhaps richness in God means caring about each other and striving for equity and inclusion of all God's people. This sounds a lot like the church and the Anglican Communion. On a good day, and it strives to become rich towards God. We have to continually renew our relationships with each other and with God to make the church rich towards God. The good news is that for the next 10 days or so, the 650 bishops from around the world are talking with each other and creating a web of friendships and dialogue across cultures. This can only lead the Anglican Communion to be richer towards God. The good news is there are now 97 female bishops in the Anglican Communion, up from 18 in 2008 and only 8 in 1998, showing that the worldwide Anglican movement is growing in richness towards God. The good news is that here at St. Paul's, we are sponsoring 3 members of the Tongan congregation in the ordination process, and you have called your first female rector in Sarah Stewart. Here in our corner of the Anglican Communion, I think we are growing in richness towards God. All of this points to a generosity of spirit and trust in God's love. All of this points to being rich in God. There is a meme that has bounced around the internet recently that says, "When the harvest is large, don't build bigger barns, build a bigger table." Being rich in God teaches us to build that bigger table for people who are hungry for God's love and to share it with them. Let us remember and pray for the larger table being set around the Anglican Communion as we come to Christ's table and receive the richness of God's love for us. Amen.
God, that all who confess your name may be united in your truth, live together in your love, and reveal your glory in the world. Lord, in your mercy, guide the people of this land and of all nations in the ways of justice and peace, that we may honor one another and serve the common good. Lord, in your mercy, give us all the reverence for the earth as your own creation, that we may use its resources rightly in the Bless all whose lives are closely linked with ours, and grant that we may serve Christ in them and love one another as he loves us. Lord, in your mercy. We pray in gratitude for our community during this ongoing leadership transition. Let us continue to pray in thanksgiving for our search committee, our vestry, especially our wardens, our transition rector, Beth, and staff, and our rector to be Sarah. May the Spirit continue to guide the ways they have all been able to listen to God's call for who we are, for who St. Paul's is, and for who we are to be. Lord, in your mercy, comfort and heal all those who suffer in body, mind, and spirit. Give them courage and hope in their troubles and bring them the joy of your salvation. We pray especially for Brigitte Anderson, Margaret Aubrey, Brock, Sharon B., Cindy Bodenlos, Leslie Bonino, Anne George, Tiana Fave, Dylan Gura, Cheryl Grzewski, Ruth Haynes, Alexandra Hopkins, David Kosnick, Larry Margolin, Mary Jo Schwann, Lisa Strebing, Brian Tanner, people of Ukraine, people of Russia, people of Afghanistan, people of the Philippines. Lord, in your mercy, we commend to your mercy all who have died, that your will for them may be fulfilled, and we pray that we may share with all your saints in your eternal kingdom. Lord, in your mercy.
Almighty and eternal God, ruler of all things in heaven and earth, mercifully accept the prayers of your people and strengthen us to do your will. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Let us confess our sins against God and our neighbor. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We have truly sorry and we want to repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways.
Sins through our Lord Jesus Christ, strengthen you in all.
Yes. gracious God, we come with joyful hearts of expectation, offering prayers to you for unity, strength, and great success for our men and hearts. And as officials of your church guide us in your direction, to share it with each other, and to carry out the will, we pray, dear Lord, that they continue to fill them with the spirit of love, and that as they manifest it, they may transform lives of these shepherds, and the flock to whom we minister. And then, Lord, it is our duty that the transformed children of your kingdom will be used in this day. See you transform ours by your love flowing through us. These mercies we ask in the name of the one who loved us to death, Jesus the Christ. Amen.
We also have a prayer for our diocesan transition. This is, of course, Bishop Mark has announced his retirement, but it's 2 years out, and they are working on putting together the research committee, and I am really pleased with the way that it's going out. If you have any connection to diocesan email, you have probably received email, or it's in the Tuesday newsletter about this coming search committee forming, and so the whole thing will be very transparent. So I offer this prayer for you all to take home with you as you take home your bulletin. We also have the backpack, Operation Backpack is continuing. It's been stretched out to August. And so that is something that we can all get behind. I noticed it is that time of year since I was at Target yesterday and saw the many, a whole half of Target is back to school already. So it's something that we can all get behind. Let's see. I would like to pass it to Susan to talk about music and some calls.
Good morning. It's a joy to be back here at St. Paul's. As you know, the choir. The choir was in residence for a week at Wells Cathedral in England. It was an amazing experience. And you will hear more about it if you haven't been following on social media. If that's not your thing, I assure you there'll be reports in different ways, both written and in early fall. We'll make sure to have a little seminar that you can hear more about it. It's good to see some people closely connected and who were there this morning. Today, I am joined by Johnny Willey, who is soon off to college, and he is going to help me teach a new hymn, but I also would like to recognize him for his longtime contributions to the music of with an inscription, Dear Johnny, receive this book with gratitude for your many gifts to the Ministry of Music at St. Paul's Burlingame, and blessings to you as you begin college. May music always bring great joy to you. So in addition to playing the Prelude and Postlude today, I have recruited Johnny to help teach a new hymn. As you know, our hymnal is from 1982, and we still find new things in it. But it's nice to be able to draw on some more recent hymn composition. And if you look at page 11, I think this might be a nice hymn to add to our repertoire. Maybe it would be a part of our celebration of a new ministry or Reverend Sarah Stewart, but let's see what you think of it. Just a little teaching around it to make it easier to sort out. You see it's in, you see those numbers 4-2, it looks like a fraction. And many of you know that means that there are four beats to a bar, and the two means a half note gets a beat. And that's that note that has the empty head and a stem. So that's your heartbeat of the piece. So that means the quarters with the filled in head and the stem, those you fit two into your heartbeat. Sing my soul his wondrous love. Whew. And I'm just going to ask you to first just start by reading the text with me. We get one heartbeat to breathe. And breathe. Sing my soul his wondrous love. Who from yon bright throne above, ever watchful o'er our race, still extends to us his grace. Still extends to us his grace. And I'm going to ask Johnny to come up. He's going to play phrase by phrase, and then we'll echo using this first stanza again. And then after the offertory sentence, you're in charge of today's anthem. So this is going to be today's anthem. Okay, why don't we go ahead and stand. Johnny will play the first phrase, and then we're going to sing the first phrase, sing my soul.
Thank you.
sun, moon, and stars, earth, winds, and waters, and every living thing. You made us in your image and taught us to walk in your ways. But we rebelled against you and wandered far away. And yet, as a mother cares for her children, you would not forget us. Time and again, you called us to live in the fullness of your love. And so this day, we join with saints and angels in the chorus of praise that rings through eternity, lifting our voices to magnify you as we sing. Christ, our Passover, is sacrificed for us.